CataractCoach.com, podcast number 36 with Lloyd Williams, bringing vision miracles to patients around the world. Welcome back to our Cataract Coach podcast. Today we have Dr. Lloyd Williams, who's an ophthalmologist at Duke University, doing anterior segment surgery, cataract, cornea, refractive surgery. But I really want to talk to him about his humanitarian efforts. And so welcome to our podcast, Lloyd.
Thank you.
Now tell me, what's been your path in ophthalmology?
I started actually in general surgery at Tufts University, and I did my summer in Zambia working at a small mission hospital where my father knew one of the surgeons there. And so it was a 200-bed hospital. I was one of two medical students and three doctors running the entire place.
Oh,
and
busy.
I spent the whole summer there. And at the very end of the summer, a guy from Ghana named Wani Mena came, and he did cataract surgery. And my job was to take the bandages off the next day. And I was like, holy cow, this is the most incredible thing I've ever seen. And all these blind people could see. So that's how I got into ophthalmology.
So then you switched gears. You left general surgery, switched ophthalmology.
Yep.
Well, that's not easy.
Nope. But it was in med school. So, you know, it was early enough to not have to have already done like gen surge residency, which of course would be painful.
Of course. So then you did your residency at Utah, which is a fantastic program.
Right. And I was fortunate enough to be there when Jeff Tabin was there. And
for sure.
So Jeff, of course, is a wonderful humanitarian, does a lot of things overseas. And Jeff and Alan Crandall invited me to go to South Sudan with them on a trip that was made into the movie Duke County. And I was just lucky to be the resident who got to tag along with those two great men.
So that was probably about 10 years ago then.
Yep. 2012. Yep.
Now, when you go on these trips as a resident, it's a lot tougher because people may not realize on a charity trip, you have the most severe cases, the toughest cataracts, and the most rudimentary equipment.
Right. So they didn't let me do any cataract surgery. it's totally appropriate for a resident on a trip like that. But what I had learned in the time I was in Zambia is I'd learned how to do trachoma procedures. And so I did about 100 Tribu lid rotations for trachoma while Alan and Jeff were doing cataract surgery.
Well, tell us about that, because as an American ophthalmologist only trained here, I've done exactly zero trachoma surgeries. So I don't know anything about it.
Yeah, we even saw one at Moran when I was a resident, and the plastics surgeon who was the attending was asking me, the resident, what my techniques were. And then our scrub nurse had actually been an ophthalmologist in Ethiopia. So he was the scrub nurse was the most experienced surgeon in the room, followed by the resident, followed by the attending. So yeah, it's not something you see a lot here, but
tell me about the procedure. What does it involve?
So as you know, the eyelids are rotated in and the lashes are scraping on the cornea. So what we do is take a Calasian clamp, sit it on the lid, and with 2 6-0 silk sutures, use that to evert the lid, make an incision through the tarsal plate, and then restitch it with a double mattress suture of Vicryl so that you evert that plate. At first, it's, you know, day one, it's not a beautiful looking procedure, but as the Vicryl disintegrates, the lid will come down a little bit and sit in a pretty normal position, and people look pretty good, and the lashes are off the cornea.
Wow, sounds like you could do it pretty efficiently then. Probably 5 minutes an eyelid with just local anesthesia.
Correct. Yep.
That is. We'll have to get a video of this from you one day and post this online, because I don't think I've ever seen this procedure being done.
I'll try to get one. I'm going to be in South Sudan in December, and there we'll certainly see some and see if we can get a good video of it.
Yeah, take your GoPro, take your iPhone. You'll be surprised at the quality you can capture.
Yeah, I'll do that.
So you did your first mission trip when you were a resident.
Correct.
And then you got bit with the bug. You've been doing this many times now.
Yeah. So when I was in private practice in Utah for 6 years before I came to Duke after I finished my fellowship at Wilmer. And so I did about one or two trips a year when I was in private practice, but I really wanted to do more. So when Terry Kim and I were negotiating coming to Duke, I asked Terry if he'd let me spend a minimum of 2 months a year overseas. And so he said, yeah, sure. So since I got here, other than the little bit of time that we didn't travel much during COVID, I've been going about 8 to 10 times a year.
To which places primarily?
South Sudan and Sierra Leone. I'm the country coordinator for Himalayan Cataract Project. So I go each of those places a couple times at least. But I've also been going to Honduras, Zambia, Guatemala, Jamaica. So we try to spread it around a little bit. El Salvador recently.
Oh, fantastic. So when you go on these, kind of explain to us, what supplies are you taking with us? What are you taking on this trip?
Yeah, it depends. Like in South Sudan, a lot of the supplies Himalayan Cataract Project sends ahead. And so usually I'm responsible for me and my own instruments, but the rest of it's already been sent ahead. So we try to only work with local partners so that I'm rarely bringing a big team or a large amount of equipment. In fact, I'm usually bringing myself and one or two other people to meet up with entirely local teams. So
pretty small.
Yeah. So the most recent trip to South Sudan, we were out in a place, you got to fly 2 hours, land on a dirt runway, get in a boat, go 2 hours up the Nile River in a boat to a place that has no roads or anything. And it was me and then all South Sudanese for the rest of the team. And I like that style because then the local people have the idea, which is true, that they're being treated by their own people and that, that it's South Sudanese solutions to South Sudanese problems. And if I can sort of hang in the background so that I'm not the star, I try to make the local people the star who are really doing the work. And then I try to hang out in the background, do the surgery, you know, but be sort of quiet and under the radar, helping facilitate local people solving local problems.
Well, that's fantastic. So you're doing a lot of what I do. What you're doing, you're being a cataract coach.
That's right.
You're coaching surgery, basically.
Lots of teaching.
Doing some as well, but an integral part of these trips is teaching.
That's right. And in that vein, of course, I love what you do. It's so great. I think you might know that I helped start the Moran Corps teaching program at the Moran Eye Center. So, you know, just a very similar idea in terms of how important it is and how much of a difference you make by teaching people, helping people improve their skills. And your videos, of course, are being used by our fellows and residents and stuff all the time, which is awesome.
It's a fun project. We have to get one of your surgeries on there for sure.
Yeah, it's great. We have some fun ones. So
if you have a young doctor, let's say, as you said earlier, it's not great for a resident to do this because you don't quite have the skill set yet. But let's say you have a young ophthalmologist, maybe 3, 4, 5 years in the practice, done a couple thousand cases, a couple thousand cataracts. How does that young doctor get involved to do one of these trips?
One of the things I think is most useful, and this is actually one thing I did early on too, is I knew people through Jeff in Nepal. And I flew and I spent 2 weeks doing surgery with Biddy Apant in Nepal, basically for 14 straight days. And I mean, all class to that guy. That guy is an animal. We did surgery for 14 days in a row. Every day we saw like 100 people in clinic and then did 50 surgeries in the afternoon. But just sitting there and getting the reps in next to somebody who's a really good manual small incision extra cap surgeon is super important. Unless, you know, there are places like where we go in Honduras on the island of Roatan, there is FACO there. And so I think you kind of have a choice. You can choose to spend time in the slightly nicer environments where you're going to have FACO, and then you just need to master FACO of hard cataracts and things like that. And be flexible with your instruments and in particular, the view through the scope. I think not seeing through a clear microscope is maybe the hardest aspect of the surgeries out there. But if you're going somewhere where you got to do M6, I would recommend going to Tenwek or Nepal or India or one of the places where you can really sit with somebody and get through M6 training and do reps for a week or two minimum so that you're comfortable. The last time I was in suture, we didn't have a retractor. We didn't have anything that you would need to clean up a mistake. And so everything has to be perfect every time. And you know, that's not a situation you want to go into with only a few M6 under your belt.
For sure. I mean, the trips that I've done, the very limited phaco, most patients were MSICS, M6.
Yeah.
A small percent we could do phaco on, let's say like you had a younger patient, 40, 50 years old with just a dense PSC cataract, you can get it done with that. But we used older generation phaco machines, often the small portable ones. And As you said, we're using microscopes that literally say on them, made in West Germany. So it's like, wait a minute, this is like 1989 or before.
That's right.
So I think it's a very important point that even if you expect to go to this place and do phaco, you're not going to have a $100,000 or $200,000 microscope. You're going to have a generations old. And that's why it really is a test of your skill.
Yeah. The by far the hardest part is not being able to see.
Right. And in terms of M6, I think it's an important procedure. M6, if you don't know, is manual small incision cataract surgery, although I changed it. The S, instead of small, I call it shelved incision. So manual shelved incision cataract surgery, because there's no way it's a small incision.
It's not small. It's like half the eye.
Right. But the surgeons who are very good at this are amazing. I've been to India and seen surgeons do M6. Like I saw one surgeon do 100 in a morning.
Yeah.
It's unbelievable the dexterity and the skill. And as you say, it's important to learn this. When I was teaching residents, I taught for 22 years at UCLA, retiring last year from academics. I taught every resident I could MSICS. You got to learn this. You got to learn M6. And we do a few cases here and there. And even in Beverly Hills in my private clinic now, I'll do M6 at least once, twice, three times a year.
Yeah, it comes up. I teach the fellows M6 here at Duke every year. We'll get enough of them that I'll be able to teach each fellow. And it's surprising, you know, somebody will come and it's like a pharmaceutical executive who's got a white cataract, but is NLP and wants it out for cosmetic purposes or something.
Right.
And because you think, like, how did you end up with a white cataract? Like, why didn't you get that fixed? What, you know, and they're like, well, now that it's so bad, nobody will do it. And then they end up in my office and I'm like, oh yeah, we can do that. You know, and then you do M6 and the fellows get some experience. So it comes up.
David Chang had a famous study he published where he did phaco and comparing himself to Sandok Ruit in the other room doing M6 on equivalent grade cataracts. And like, no question, M6 was better for those dense rocks.
Right. For sure. For sure. So it's a great procedure. And I think just at minimum, as a surgeon in America, knowing how to make a good scleral tunnel, super important. That's going to come up for, you know, I use that all the time for artificial iris cases, putting in a CZ70. There's a wide variety of sort of complex lens cases where a scleral tunnel is a really useful thing to be able to make well. You know, without having to suture it or anything.
Such an important key. I had a video sent to me of a surgeon explanting an AC lens, AC IOL. And the surgeon makes this huge 6.5 millimeter corneal incision. And I just cringe. And I think, you know, you could have had a beautiful scleral tunnel.
Yeah, exactly. With no astigmatism. Yeah. So,
right. Absolutely. So I think that's important. So if you're doing your training now, we have a lot of young residents who listen to our podcast. Our podcast and our videos kind of skew to the younger audience.
Yeah.
I'm kind of the top end of that. Most of them are in the 30s and 40s. You have to learn how to do a scleral tunnel, whether it's even just for a phaco incision. Let's say I had a patient this week. I had two patients, 20 cut RK, 16 cut RK.
Yeah.
You got to make a scleral tunnel. So you need to know how to do that. But also you need to learn M6. So how would a young doctor, either in residency or let's say, in the first couple years of practice, learn M6. How do you learn it?
Yeah, so I think one of the places to start, AAO and Ascaris usually have an M6 course. There are also now some global ophthalmology meetings. I know Jeff Petty has set up some. He's a great guy at Moran. And so there are courses to learn or begin M6. Usually you're doing it on a pig eye on some of those, which, as you know, is it's different enough that you could be great at doing M6 on pig eyes and still struggle on human eyes. I think that's a great start. And then once you kind of build that a little bit, you know, finding a mentor, if you know someone here who can mentor you, great. But like I said, I think if you can hang out with one of those guys in India who does 100 in a morning, spending time, you know, and that's how it was with me and Bidia. We'd have 50 cases every afternoon and he'd say, okay, we're going to start. And when we're done, we're done. And you get to do as many as you can. And I never made it past 10 or 11 before he finished the other 39 or 40.
Right. You know,
but I think that's so important. I learned a ton from him and I sat down and I really spent time watching how he did it. There's some really good videos now online as well, where people kind of walk you through the fine details. Because there's a lot of things, there's a lot of things that you don't see when you first watch a video on M6. You know, and they just pull out the lens. You know, you don't see all the little subtle movements that go into that. So being able to sit down with somebody and really talk through, well, how did you get the lens to come out? You know, did you burp it out? Did you pull it out? Like some of those little details.
Yeah, like any procedure, the subtleties take a little time to learn. I have actually a video on cataract coach of my four main pearls of learning M6. And I have a cheat code that I would teach all the residents. My cheat code is, after I get the lens nucleus up in the AC above the iris, I'd make a para 180 degrees opposite of my big incision. And then I'd use the lens loop, but then I'd just use a spatula on the other side and I'd literally push the nucleus right out.
Sure.
You don't have to worry about the subtlety of the fluid wave and the pressure and the viscoelastic injection and that'll also prevent you from scraping the corneal endothelium.
Yeah, because I think that's one of the things that I didn't understand in the first few is I felt like you could just lift it up and pull it out, you know, and then you scrape off the endo and that's no good. That's a great idea. You could even push it out from the backside with viscoelastic and stuff too, rather than reach across. But yeah, anything that pressurizes the inside of the eye so it wants to come out is great. That's a great idea.
And that's an important procedure to learn. Now, you must be doing other things as well. You must do some like lid cases or strabismus cases, some cornea cases. I don't know if you have ability to do transplants at these various locations.
Yeah. So we did, to my knowledge, and you know, you never know on some of these things, somebody may call me up and say, hey, you're totally wrong. I did one of those 30 years ago. But to my knowledge, we did the first cornea transplants in Sierra Leone with Jalico Mustafa, who's the head of their eye program there. And who actually was just a month or two ago promoted to Deputy Minister of Health. And we've now done 52 transplants in Sierra Leone.
Wow.
And our first transplant was a lady who'd been LP only in her better eye for 29 years.
That is amazing.
So, that was super exciting. And one of those cases where you think, I don't know, this graft might not survive in this eye. But it's survived beautifully, and it's just really beautiful to see her come out and see her kids for the first time, see her husband for the first time. Like, she'd never seen anything since she was a teenager, and she's in her mid-40s. So
tell me more about that, because one of the things that struck me the most, when I did some of these trips, like I went to Tonga in the middle of South Pacific, mm-hmm. near Fiji and Samoa, and I went with the big group of people. We did these cases. I had a woman who was bilateral white cataracts for like 10 years.
Yeah.
And she was the grandma. And I didn't realize also is that in those places, there's no seeing eye dog. There's a seeing eye child. There's a grandchild.
That's right.
Who holds one end of a stick. Grandma holds the other. And that kid has no life. The kid's full-time job is to be the eyes for grandma.
100%.
I'll never forget the moment where you take off the patch and she sees. She literally... My favorite part was she looked at her son and she said, who are you? And he says, I'm your son. She's like, you're so old. And then the son says, don't look in a mirror.
Yeah, that's hilarious. Totally true. The kids is, I think you can make a strong case that there's nothing you could do in some of these countries that would put more kids in school than cataract surgery for the dollar.
Yeah.
I think you could make a really strong case that there's no intervention that would put more kids in school for the dollar in a place like South Sudan or Sierra Leone or some of these places. than doing cataract surgery, because none of those kids can go to school. And there's thousands and thousands and thousands of kids whose lives are essentially being lost or postponed due to blindness of an older family member.
So what is it like? Explain us the kind of the emotions, because for most ophthalmologists in the U.S. probably have not done a trip like this. You've done many. I've done a few. Explain what the emotions like this woman, you said her better eye was LP. You do the transplant. The next day you take the patch off, and then what?
So she's kind of stunned, you know, and of course transplants don't see it quite as well as cataracts, but she's like 2100 and she's a little stunned. And then she gets up and she walks out, and this girl is standing outside the door and she starts crying. And the woman we just operated on turns to her and says, "Girl, why are you crying?" And she's like, "I'm your daughter." And then she recognizes the voice. Mm-hmm. And then everybody in the whole building started crying. It was such a beautiful moment. And we actually, I was able to have a photographer who travels with me go to her house and just sit with her and talk to her about how her life has changed. She actually has a job now. She's her husband, amazingly, her husband is also blind. So of the two of them, she's the only one with a job now. And she said, you know, one of the things I like most about this is when I tell my children to clean their room, I know whether they did it. And the kids are like, "Oh no, mom can see." But you just think about all these little things that, you know, but 15 years before, her village got attacked in the Sierra Leone Civil War. And you can imagine picking up your baby with your eyes closed and running out of a village into the forest while people are shooting at you. You don't even know if you're running towards them or away from them. I mean, the terror must have been, I just can't even begin to comprehend what that must have felt like. You know, and our second transplant that we did was a girl who went blind at 10, both eyes. At 20, we did her first transplant. We actually did a transplant on her other eye. She's now 20/30. In each eye approximately. And, you know, when I met her, she sat like this. She never even tried to look at you. She wouldn't
like head down, looking at the ground,
head down, looking at the ground, only mumbles at you, you know. And before we even did her second eye, she came in and she was like wearing this bright red shirt and look you right in the eye. And I want to get my other eye done because I want to do things, and I've got a life that I've got planned, and I want to become a minister of health, and I want to change eye care in Sierra Leone, and that's what I'm going to do with my life, you know. And I thought, I actually turned to the person beside me and I said, "Who is this girl?" And they're like, "Oh, she's the one you did the transplant on." And I looked at her, yeah, she's the one I did. I mean, I would never even, her personality, everything about her was so different. It's really incredible what being able to see does for people, the change that it makes in everything.
Yeah, the gift of sight is truly miraculous, truly life-changing.
Yeah.
I'm like you, I'm thankful every day that I'm an ophthalmologist. What a blessing, absolute blessing.
It is the greatest, like it is so great. I mean, saving people's lives in general surgery was great, but a lot of times you put people kind of back together and then they're like, yeah, it's good, but I got this like problem still or whatever. You know, you treat diabetes and you're like, yeah, you know, you can't eat anything you want ever again in your life. You're gonna have to stick yourself in your finger and inject yourself forever. Mm-hmm. And if you don't, then your legs are gonna get cut off. You know, who's happy about that?
That's a lot tougher now.
You meet these people and you're like, in 5 minutes, now you're not blind and I don't have to do anything else. Like there's little follow-up. It's really incredible. Cataract surgery in particular is the coolest thing.
Right. So, I mean, a white cataract, literally a 5-minute procedure.
Yeah.
You're fixed.
That's right.
It's mind blowing.
Yep.
Now how did you get, where did the corneas come from? Did you bring in corneas? Do you have some sort of banking system there? How do you arrange all this?
Yeah, corneas is a tricky one because there are few, if any, active eye banks in Africa. People have worked on it. There's one in Kenya. They don't get a lot of eyes. There's one in Ethiopia. There's a guy from Utah starting one in Mali. But for the most part, there's no real reliable source of corneas in Africa right now, unless you're in South Africa or Egypt or one of the countries that's really quite a bit more advanced. And so generally I'm just bringing them. Even to when we went to El Salvador a few weeks ago, I brought the corneas down with me. So they're mostly donated from the United States. And that's a tricky and interesting proposition too, as you're trying to bring them through the airport in Paris or variety of other places, trying to get there fast enough without all the ice melting and trying to convince Delta Airlines that they can't put them in the cargo hold under the plane and some of that stuff. So we've had some interesting experiences. Oddly enough, usually the easiest is when you actually get to Sierra Leone and the guy says, "What's in the box?" And you say, "Oh, it's human eyeballs." And they're like, "Whoa, move away, move along. Not interested. Don't want to see them." So,
but you're not taking the whole globe. You're taking the pre-prepared grafts.
Yeah, just grafts. And gotcha. We've done 2 D-secs in Sierra Leone, but it's mostly PKs.
And then how many corneas do you take and how long do they last?
A cornea will last about 2 weeks. Usually by the time you've got it, it's been in a jar for about a week. Mm-hmm. So we'll take about 20, somewhere between 15 and 20, and make sure that we've got that many patients lined up. Well, in fact, we'll usually try to line up about 30 to 35 patients for, say, 20 corneas, because some people might not show up or some people might not be a good candidate. And then we try to do all the transplants within 4 days.
On your trip, let's say you're there a couple of weeks, all the transplants at the very beginning, obviously. And then cataracts can obviously wait a week or two.
That's right.
What other surgeries are doing that? So you got the mostly cataract, a lot of trachoma, a little bit of cornea. What else are you doing there?
Those are the big ones. We do a few pterygiums. You don't see as many pterygiums in Africa as you do, say, in Central America. But it does come up. We've been doing pterygiums with blood patch, which is sort of nature's Tocele. I studied some of the things that the Kenyans and other people were inventing, and that's pretty cool. It actually works really well. And that's about it. You know, usually I'm not that good at the strabismus stuff. So I've been sort of avoiding that. I took a big dermoid cyst. It was a dermoid cyst about half the size of an eyeball off a little kid's eye not too long ago in Sierra Leone, which was made possible by having some corneal tissue to fill in the hole. But so you run into a few sort of random things like that. And usually when you're there, you'll run into some massive ocular facial tumor that is completely beyond your ability to sure. deal with because of the airway issues and everything else that it would take. And it's pretty tragic to turn those away. I think when they show up and they see, you know, "Oh, a doctor from Duke, this is my last hope." And it hurts to say, "I can't help you."
Yeah, I'm sure. That's a tough situation. But you're limited by your resources and you're limited by, you know, what you can do. Tell me about Duke Global Ophthalmology Program. So what does that entail?
So Duke Global Ophthalmology, we're hoping to have a global fellow soon, like the Moran and Wills and the Stanford programs. And the rest of it is Duke being involved in education. So we're working on training mid-level staff in South Sudan, and we're working with Leon Herndon in training glaucoma fellows overseas, as well as cornea. So Dr. Mustafa in Sierra Leone has done at least 15 of the 50 transplants that we've done there. And I've trained her to the point that she actually did a mission trip with me to El Salvador to do cornea transplants, which I thought was just the coolest thing. So that's been pretty exciting. So, you know, we try to train people in cornea and glaucoma procedures internationally. We're hoping to have our own fellow pretty soon. And we're hoping to help Sierra Leone actually start building a national eye center of excellence, which I think is going to change the country and by extension, the whole region of West Africa, where Sierra Leone's located. Right now they have one operating microscope and one slit lamp in the National Eye Hospital, you know, and I think we can get to the point where there's a dozen of each and eye surgeons operating every day of the week and really making a big difference.
Yeah, I think we can get there too. I think probably the most important thing you're doing though is the teaching, because that has the far greater impact.
Absolutely. Yep. I mean, it's fun. I love doing cataract surgery over there, just like you do. But the more I can teach and the more I can help them do more, the better.
Oh, no, for absolutely. I think that's neat. So you've got a lot of different projects here, and you're doing now about 2 months a year, you said, about for traveling?
Yep.
And how do you schedule those? Do you just do like a week or two at a time, or how do you break up your calendar?
Yeah, usually a week or two at a time. As you know, if you go to a place and 1,000 people show up for cataract surgery, if you've got enough fast surgeons, you can clear that out in a week or two, and then you're kind of done. And so then you come back, do some work, and then go and do it again in a different place. So that's generally how that works.
Now, are you doing any lens calcs at all too? Are you doing like a little portable A-scan or keratometer too?
Uh-huh. Yep. So at Himalayan Cataract Project and at Duke, we believe that not putting in lenses or not putting in the right power lenses is not a great favor to people, particularly in places where glasses really aren't available. So we have an A-scan and a portable keratometer that we do lens calcs on every patient.
And then aiming for probably not ametropia then, probably minus one?
Minus a half, plano minus one. You know, you don't always have exactly the lens you would hope, but somewhere in that range. Yeah, usually about minus a half-ish.
I can attest being a little myopic has been a gift. So what's next then? So besides Sierra Leone, I was doing some homework here. It looks like you also did stuff in Zambia before.
Uh-huh.
You said you're now doing El Salvador, a little bit of Jamaica. Are you expanding beyond that as well?
I'm hoping that as Duke Global Ophthalmology grows, what will happen is my colleagues begin to expand out. I mean, obviously, if I'm doing 8 trips a year, if I'm going to more than 8 places, then I'm not going to each one very often. And I think you have to work with the same people over and over and over to have the maximum impact. And so my commitments really strongly are Sierra Leone and South Sudan. And part of that is those are places where there's a really great core of ophthalmologists that are early to mid-career, and a real will to make a difference. And at the same time, those are countries that have a lot of eye problems to tackle. So, you know, a lot of pathology and a really great nucleus of people who are beginning to address it. And I feel like that's a place where we can make the maximum difference. But then other attendings have their own connections in various places. And so I'm encouraging people to, you know, if you've got a friend in the Congo or you got a friend in Thailand or wherever it is, then you want to work with them, then, you know, then that's your place. And make the most of it. And I'll try to help you put that together. And so we're hoping that the outreach of Duke Global extends into a lot of other places, but there's a limit to how many I can do, at least at this point, since I still have to work. I still have to work for money sometimes, you know?
You know, what's interesting though, sometimes the pathology you see is very different. Like you said, trachoma. Another one that struck me is just before COVID, I did a charity trip to Tanzania. Actually did Tanzania and Zambia, but in Tanzania, what struck me was in the USA, in my 25 years of practice, I've seen one patient with congenital rubella, microcornea, glaucoma, cataract, one, who was born outside the US and came to our county hospital.
Right.
I saw 30 patients in one day in Tanzania with congenital rubella and the microcornea, the glaucoma, the cataract in a day.
That's incredible.
And yeah. So just like, some of the things that we take for granted, like a 25-cent MMR vaccine, is just not done there.
Yeah, or OSSN, that's another one in Zambia and the Southern Africa. from the extent of HIV.
Right.
You know, I mean, I see OSSN 5 times a year, you know, oculus surface squamous neoplasia. At Duke, there you might see it 20 times in a trip.
Right.
Doing that kind of stuff. Yeah, you're right. You definitely see some things that you wouldn't see here. And that can be exciting and terrifying, both.
Right. It's yes, certainly humbling. I'll give you that.
Yeah.
Now, for your
Onco, Onco's another interesting. Like, when was the last time you saw Onco here?
Oh, Onco, guys, I have never seen one in the U.S.
Yeah, exactly. So
right, river blindness, never seen it.
Yeah, and you're there, and you look at somebody's retina, and you're like, "Good Lord, what is all that stuff in there?" And they're like, "Oh, that's Onco." And the next one, you're like, "What? That's Onco." You're like, "What is that? That's Onco." And you're like, "Okay, I think I figured it out. If it looks crazy, it's Onco." But yeah, there's a lot of that stuff. So. You know, I think that brings up a point, which is I learn, I think, as much from them as they learn from me.
Oh, for sure.
I mean, the teaching is 100% both ways. And I think Dr. Mustafa and Dr. Albino in South Sudan and stuff, I hope that they see me as an equal colleague, because it's certainly how I see them.
Right. You know, I felt the same way, that the ophthalmologists in these other places, we had complementary skill sets. We're kind of right. Yin and yang. I've got something that they need to learn, and they've got a lot that I need to learn. So it definitely is a two-way street.
Absolutely.
So for your fellowship, you're going to start at Duke. It'll be a one-year fellowship, so post-residency fellowship.
Correct.
And then how do you think you're going to structure this? I mean, it's not set in stone just yet, but how would you structure it in the trips and overseas and how much in the U.S. and what's it going to be like?
I would think approximately 8 months in the U.S. and 4 months overseas. I would plan on them spending some time in Nepal at the very beginning of the fellowship to master M6. And then we'd find a project that fits them that they could go and work on overseas and then spend the rest of the time getting real cornea skills and some of the cataract skills with me at Duke as well. But it depends a little bit on, you know, one individual may have a greater propensity towards glaucoma, a different one may like cornea, and another one might just want to do cataract. And I think we have the ability, at least at Duke, to really structure that based on the individual.
Well, that's fantastic. You get such a broad experience, you know. You can focus on one particular, but you get a broad experience.
Right.
You know, we had a podcast on with a young doctor named Christos Ifantidis.
I know him.
Yeah, he's a fantastic young ophthalmologist. He did the global fellowship at Wills.
Correct.
And he says that 1 year taught him so much. He then became faculty in Colorado and then has since left to do private practice. But he's an amazing, outstanding surgeon. But
he's really great. Christos and I were in Sierra Leone together once.
Oh, awesome.
Work at a village way out at a place called Cerebu. Where Kathy Schanzer set up just an amazing eye clinic there that's been running for a couple decades. Christos and I spent time out there. Christos is an amazing guy, somebody I really look up to.
Oh, yeah, great guy for sure. But I want to kind of emphasize that even if you intend to practice your career, obviously in the USA, like essentially 99% of USA ophthalmology residents intend, this year of global will not only give you this exposure to worldwide ophthalmology, but it'll give you a skill set that's otherwise very difficult to acquire.
Agreed. And I think it also gives you an ability to manage fear in the OR.
Right.
You know, because as you know, throughout your career, new techniques come up, all kinds of things. Everything you do that's new feels scary at first, like the first time you do a DMEC, the first time you do a DALK. It doesn't always work the first time. You try your first DALK, you break the decimase, you end up doing a PK, and then you think, oh, that doesn't work, and you quit. Mm-hmm. But when you do the international stuff, you develop a way of thinking about surgery that allows you to persevere through things and to be able to accept and manage some risk that I think you don't really get when you practice only here.
Right. You said at the beginning of the podcast here, you said you're doing surgery with no safety net. So there is, if you drop the nucleus during phaco, there is no ability to do a pars plana vitrectomy. There is no posterior segment, you know, viewing system. That doesn't exist.
That's right.
So don't drop the nucleus.
That's right. You drop the nucleus, it's gone. That's it.
Yeah. So that's an added level of pressure there. Now, on a different note here, how do you avoid getting sick on these trips, like food poisoning in particular or contaminated water? Because that's been one of my challenges on some of these trips.
Yeah, that's a big one. You know, obviously, I take my malaria meds when I'm supposed to and that kind of stuff. But a lot of the things that you can't really avoid, at least not through vaccines and other things like that. I managed to get COVID in Nepal. Okay. Back at the very beginning of 2020 and was sick as a dog for like months. So I've been hit by things before, but I've also been blessed. I don't know whether it's because my parents were missionaries in Papua New Guinea when I was a little kid, but I've got a pretty iron stomach. All my travels in Africa, I've never really gotten any big stomach bug or anything like that. So maybe that was five years of living in New Guinea as a kid. Maybe I developed like some sort of parasitemia that has held out for me for the rest of my life.
You got a different antibody set than most of us here in the US.
Yeah, maybe that's it. Cause I usually don't get sick, and I've had to do trips where, you know, you're the guest of honor at some village out in the middle of nowhere and you think, oh man, here goes. You know, I don't know what I'm going to get, but probably something. But so far I've been lucky. But you know, sadly, you're not always lucky. I have seen people get really quite sick, right. and be ill for years after a humanitarian trip. So it's something that is that and the potential for violence and other things. Those are things which are real. And you know, the Duke County movie, after we left, 140 people were killed in a massacre in that village. Goodness. 2 weeks after we left. Wow. And the tents that we had been sleeping in had bullet holes in them. The clinic that we worked in was eventually burned to the ground. I mean, that kind of violence can come, and or illness can come. And on some level, you know, you can do your best, but on some level, you don't really have any control over that. Even the last time I was in South Sudan, Dr. Albino had to not go on the trip because he was the wrong tribe. And he said, if I go to that area, somebody's likely to kill me. I said, am I okay? And he's like, look at you. They know you're not from around here. I was like, all right, I'll go. But you know, it's real. I've thought about it a lot. And what I've come to the conclusion is that although I don't want to die in the pursuit of curing global blindness, I am willing to accept that as a risk, because I think curing global blindness is something that is worth risking your life for.
Now, to be clear, it's a tiny, tiny risk, but it's obviously a real risk.
Right.
I don't want to scare away your potential Duke global ophthalmology fellows.
And frankly, the only time I've ever been shot at in my entire life was in Durham. There is that.
Now tell me about you. You were exposed to mission work at a very young age then. I didn't realize.
Yeah. My parents, my father was a printer. And so he was hired by the Lutheran Church to go and teach printing in Papua New Guinea and start a printing operation for them and then teach local people how to print until enough people had learned how to print. And then he wouldn't have a job anymore because they could do it on their own. So we lived on the beach on the north side of Papua New Guinea, banana and pineapple plantation for my early childhood, which is not a bad place to grow up.
Well, I bet it'd be a ton of fun.
Yeah.
Oh, fantastic. It sounds like you've lived the experience. Now you're probably then taking your kids on some of these trips, the safer ones.
So I've taken one daughter to Roatan. This year will be her third time to go. I've taken another daughter. I have three kids. I've taken my other daughter to Zambia because she was there when she was little. When she was one or three and her sister was one, we lived there for 2 months with them. And then I took her back now that she's in college. And then my son is 15 now. And so probably next year in 2024, he'll get to choose where he wants to go on a trip.
Because I want them to see. Yeah. It's important.
Yeah, for sure.
I did the same thing with my son on one of these trips and my daughter as well. My son, I remember, was like kind of mid, early teenage years. I said, okay, you're going to learn. You're good at math. You're going to learn how to do some lens calcs here. Here's Apple Nation A-Scan. Here's Caretopper. Here's what it means. Do the math.
Right. Perfect, yeah.
Gave him a job.
Put her to work, and she was running stuff in the OR and sterilizing instruments. And, yeah, so I think it's important not only for them to see that the entire rest of the world lives differently, right. And that varies from one place to another. But I wanted them to know why Dad leaves.
Yeah.
2 months out of the year. I wanted them to see the vision behind it and say, yeah, you know, maybe I wish Dad was at my soccer game, but I believe that what he's doing is good.
Right. No, it's important to get them involved early.
Yeah.
For my son, he had an idea of putting a string around their neck with a card that had their name, the eye, and the lens power, and they wore it like a big necklace.
Oh, nice! That's a great one. We tape it on the forehead, but yeah, one way or another, you got to do it.
Yeah. So it's fantastic. I think it's a very important move then with your kids. It shows a different kind of set of values, and it's things that generally kids aren't exposed to. And I think it's has a super valuable, it's a valuable experience for them. Something so different than the usual social media, iPhone, that kind of nonsense.
Sure. Sure.
So what's next for you then?
It's not the same to see it on a video either. Like getting up one morning and taking 100 badges off and seeing everybody able to see. You can't do that on a video. It's just not the same.
Right. That's a great job for a young person on the trip too, is take the patches off the next morning.
Yep. What can you see? I mean, that's the best job ever. So.
Fantastic. So what's coming next for you then? You've got a lot of stuff going on here. You're going to start the fellowship hopefully in the next year or two or three.
Yep.
What are your big ultimate goals here? I kind of browsed around your website. The Help Mercy International looks great.
Yeah. So. Projects. We've got some interesting things there, sort of smaller projects, but dealing with HIV and some things that I did before I was a resident in ophthalmology. The next really big project, I think, is working with Dr. Mustafa to build a eye center in Sierra Leone. I'm really hoping to get some serious donors and or maybe an ASHA grant or something like that to partner with her to build an eye center there. They're training 7 new ophthalmologists who should finish within the next 3 to 4 years. And so we want to have a place for them to start working and really just make a massive difference in Sierra Leone and start a residency program so that instead of sending people out, they can do the training in country. And as you know, residents do a lot of useful work. And so if you're sending everybody away to Kenya, then the Kenyans are getting all the useful work. If you can do that stuff in-house, it's a real benefit for the country.
Oh, absolutely. Well, I think you're doing amazing work here. It was really a pleasure to talk to you. Yeah. I've learned so much about this. If someone wants to reach out, how can they contact you? Through your Help Mercy International website? Or
Probably the easiest is just straight lloyd.williams@duke.edu.
Oh, that's easy enough.
Yeah.
I think you're doing amazing things and you're going to have a fantastic fellowship.
Yeah. Awesome. Thank you. It's great to finally meet you. If only virtually, because obviously, you know, I've been a big fan of what you're doing with Cataract Coach. And I can see how that is a platform by which international people can learn things too, that, you know, not just nationally here, but like when we started MoranCorps, the big idea of it was that in places where there's only like 3 general ophthalmologists running a fellowship program, how do you learn neuro or glaucoma or something that the people who are teaching you don't know? And so Cataract Coach is super awesome for that as well, in that learning phaco and stuff in some of those places, that there isn't anyone to teach. So when you sit down in Sierra Leone and you want to learn FACO, you got to find somewhere to really pick up a lot of that information. So it's really great to meet you.
Thank you. Thank you. To your point, about half of our views for Cataract Coach, a little more than half for US and a little bit less than half for outside the US. And it has a very far reach. I track all the metrics and it is basically every corner of the globe.
Yeah. Yeah. Moran Corps, same thing. I think they had 187 countries visited in the last 12 months. I mean, I don't know how many countries there are exactly. And it changes every now and then, but it can't be much more than 187.
Right.
So yeah, I wouldn't be surprised that the outreach of Cataract Coach is completely global.
Fun projects for both of us, but yeah, we both realize that, by teaching, though, we also learn a lot. I learn more than I contribute sometimes, you know?
I would think. You know, you get some really interesting videos. So yeah. I'll try to send you some.
All right, Lloyd, that would be fantastic. I look forward to that. Certainly, you can teach me the trachoma surgery. I've never even seen it in my life. We would definitely feature that video.
Okay, awesome. I'll try to get a good one. I'm going to be in South Sudan in December. We're going to try to do 2,000 cataracts in 2 weeks.
Oh, whoa. I can't end the podcast yet. I got to hold on a minute. 2,000 cataracts in 2 weeks?
Yeah.
So clearly you're not lazy.
No, and it won't be me alone, of course. I don't think I'm fast enough, but it'll be me and three other surgeons who are all South Sudanese, and we'll rotate through. We'll probably have three microscopes and just operate all day, every day.
Yeah, wow, that'll be amazing. The amount of good you'll do will be immeasurable. It'll be amazing.
Yeah, so we're super excited.
Wow, looking forward to hearing a report when you get back. And again, thank you for doing the podcast. And I want to remind all our viewers and our listeners, remember, we got a new podcast every single week now. It's on Spotify, Apple, Amazon, Google, anywhere you find your podcast, plus on cataractcoach.com, plus the videos on YouTube. Check it out, and please tell your friends.